Thanks, Dan and Kibler, for that great update segment. My name is TJ, and I'm joined by my good pal, That's Admirable, to bring you some Hearthstone action. Admirable, it's been a pretty good day so far. We've seen some interesting plays, to say the least, and so a lot of cool decks as well. A lot of variety, I think, is the main thing.
Yeah, one of the things that's so interesting to me is that variety. I mean, there really hasn't been that much of a shakeup with Karazhan, a couple of key tech cards here and there. But for the most part, we're seeing players really swap up their list for this one. It's almost like everyone tried to go that next step to catch everyone else off guard.
Mm-hmm. And that results in us getting to see some really cool lineups. And the next two players are no different. It's Teray and Chalky is going to be our next match. Chalky, of course, made it to the Winter Championship. Didn't have a very good performance there, but since then, winner at DreamHack Austin, lots of Hearthstone Championship Tour points. He's a contender for Last Call. There's lots on the line for him. And Teray, he's a player that's been around the scene for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, I think back to the World Championships where he was playing Shaman, and it was regarded as one of the worst classes there, but he put up a great performance to that deck. Everything I've seen from Teray, his lists never seem quite on point, but his play definitely is.
Yep, that's very true. And he's got an interesting C'Thun Warrior lineup, and it's actually going to be left up by Chalky, who's actually playing Shaman, Aggro Shaman, a Questing Adventure Rogue, and a Tempo Mage.
Yeah.
Chalky's bringing Rogue. Chalky's bringing Temple Mage. What does the world come to?
The world has come to the fact that he's just kind of realized that big Van Cleefs and Questing Adventurers are very good win conditions if they go unchecked by your opponent. And if you take a look at the way that Mage has panned out, he's a big believer in Firelands Portal. He thinks it's one of the most fantastic cards that's there, a very versatile card once you get to the endgame spots. And I know he's been practicing it quite a bit. I'm curious to see exactly how it's going to be performing, because so far it seems like it's been performing pretty well.
Yeah, I would definitely say so. One of the tough matchups for the overall lineup from Chalky is Zoo. Zoo can definitely beat Tempo Mage, especially without the inclusion of Flamestrike. He can beat Aggro Shaman, and sometimes it can just run over Rogue. But talking with Chalky, he seems to think that Zoo is sort of the weak link in a lot of lineups, and he says he can capitalize on that by making his win rates good against the rest of the field, and then hoping he can just go into what might be considered somewhat unfavorables against Zoo and still win.
Yeah, I mean, it's not really a bad strategy when you think about it, too, because I totally am in agreement with that. I feel like Zoo's in this weird spot where the builds aren't necessarily as explored as they should be. We've kind of been settled on this very cut-and-dry style of Zoo list for so long. You know, hopefully Karazhan shakes a bit of that up in the coming weeks, but I'm sort of, like I said, in agreement. People debate over like Doomguard and Leroy Jenkins, and that's about it.
That's about it. Yeah, there are a couple inclusions that Teray has that are a little bit interesting. Double Sea Giant. It's really only seen with Leroy Jenkins. It's not seen the Doomguard version because that's a little bit of a weird interaction. If you have Sea Giants, which are situational cards, and then you have Doomguard, which punishes you for having situational cards by discarding them, you can sometimes get into situations where you have Double Sea Giant, Doomguard. Yeah. Like, what do I do?
And it's looking like it's not going to be too effective here versus Chalky. I mean, one of the reasons that Sea Giant's such a powerful card is quite literally the Zoo Mirror. It's a very big tiebreaker if you get to a state where a lot of board tension's built. Chalky just doesn't have Warlock, and that's something that we haven't seen from Chalky in, I don't know, maybe ever.
Ever? I was going to say years? Because Chalky was a little boy, maybe even, which was only like a couple months ago, it feels like. But yeah, it's a little bit interesting. Also, just the fact that he was very outspoken about how weak of a deck Rogue was, or weak of a class Rogue was, and all of a sudden changes that. And talking to him recently, he says that Rogue is, if you eliminate Aggro Shaman from the equation, Rogue is like the highest competitive win rate deck. Which is, it's nuts to me when it was in the bottom of the barrel just not too long ago.
Yeah, a lot of that came down, I think, to the way that the decks were built. Kind of focusing the win condition more on just giant things like Questing Adventure and Edwin Van Cleef. It feels kind of scary to put all your eggs in one basket. But with that deck, that is quite literally your win condition. I mean, you think about how Rogue wins on a landslide most of the time, just a big Edwin Van Cleef. Well, if you have Questing Adventure in there, it can kind of fit the same bill. You just need stuff to do along with the 3-drop and hope it doesn't die.
Rogue's one of the best classes that's having stuff to do with lots of those cheap spells. You get more coins, preps, things like that. So definitely going to have to see how that deck performs. Teray's other decks, of course, I mentioned the sort of standard C'Thun Warrior, which a lot of people coming in were expecting Cycle C'Thun to be the more popular variation of that. because it sort of has similar matchups across the board, but better matchups against some of the faster decks. And also, he's got the Yogdruid, which is a pretty standard. It's the second most popular deck.
Behind Warrior.
And so that's... He's a little greedy there. Run Cenarius, which has been sort of cut from a lot of lists lately. Moving on in the future, we're going to see it cut a lot, too, especially with Arcane Giant. But, of course, that's not available for these guys' decks, so don't be expecting to see any Arcane Giants.
Yeah, that's something to me that is a little bit worrisome for Teray's lineup for me. Not every single player has been made aware that the Cycle C'Thun version is as powerful as it is. I mean, we've seen Oskaka in a couple of events just take that to massively... like one-sided performances.
Oh, yeah.
And as I mentioned, Teray sometimes he'll bring decks that aren't necessarily refined. It's his play that carries him for the most part because his decision-making is really on point. But his warrior being the traditional C'Thun warrior, that's one that's very hard to pick up a win with because it's just very slow, frankly.
It's very slow. Very slow. And I'm pretty sure his lineup is actually really greedy.
Yes.
He runs Gore Howl plus the Doom Caller, so he's really sort of in on those
and
slower matchups
thrown in.
And a Sylvanas. So definitely going to have to keep an eye on that matchup as Chalky did not ban the Warrior. He's got one of those interesting strategies that doesn't include banning the Warrior. It's usually the Shaman ban that comes out from him. Teray didn't have Shaman, so he banned Hunter. But interesting to say the least. So Chalky's going to open with the Aggro Shaman. Teray is going to open with the Zoo Warlock.
Yeah, this is one of those matchups where if you ask people about it, they say, oh, the Zoo Warlock's favored. But it feels like it gets closer and closer every single week. You know, Chalky's got a copy of Lightning Storm in this build. He's got one copy of Thing from Below. This build is meant to have some recovery potential versus Zoo. Now, how often that actually works out is another story. But that's the situation he's trying to create. Just have tools that can get him back in the game.
Uh-huh. And not the greatest of opening hands for Chalky. But at least he has things to do. He has a turn one play, he's got Feral Spirits, and he's got Doomhammer. Even though Doomhammer is not the greatest card to have in your opening hand, it's a great stabilization tool against you. It allows you to play sort of the board control role. And if he's able to pick up a hero power that couples well with it, whether it be Steady Shot because you can clear the board and still push damage each turn, or Shapeshift, which allows you to either deal more damage with it or help you trade on the board. Definitely wants just some sort of board control tool, whether or no matter what it be. And Dagger is the option that he settles with.
Yeah, so the Dagger here always looks like an interesting pick because you see Doomhammer and you go, wait a minute, this hero power is going to be useless.
Yeah.
But Chalky's goal quite literally is to get the board and then play the Doomhammer. And the Doomhammer is supposed to wrap up the game at that point. Mm. And so a big purpose of that is just to have the hero power meant as a tempo tool. So we can use it on this turn, get the value from it, follow it with the Feral Spirit or Lava Burst, and continue to get value from the hero power.
Yeah, very true. Wow, so a very damage-heavy hand from Chalky, but definitely not what you want to see.
Now, the Lava Bursts are concerning me a bit. Teray happens to have a Darkshire Councilman, so probably a strong target for one of those. But overall, Chalky's hand is a little bit shaky. You know, normally if you have enough minions and some cheap spells, you can wrangle the board, and then the Doomhammer can secure it. But with this hand, I think Chalky's going to be fighting from behind for a lot longer than he'd anticipated.
I tend to agree. I mean, let's just start counting damage. 10 from Lava Burst. 16 from Doomhammer. You got 26 right there. Lightning Bolt, 19. You just go face right here with the Sir Finley and you win.
That's the going face with the Sir Finley is the one that's out of the question here, but the rest of what you said isn't necessarily too far-fetched.
Yeah. If you can survive long enough to get that damage in by using some of these tools that you have as board control tools, hey, maybe you can do it.
This is a big turn here for Chalky as well. He's looking to fade Abusive Sergeant basically every single time here, and when that happens, I think he'll typically feel pretty comfortable. And not only that, but Teray's options just really are not that strong afterwards. Flame Imp's looking good, but what do you couple the Flame Imp with? The Darkshire Councilman's, you know, in the face of a Rockbiter or a Lightning Bolt, this feels bad.
Yep.
Well, he's going to go with the Councilman, and Chalky, this is one of the turns I think that he was looking to happen, is be able to handle a threat and then have the board control. And with that Argent Horse Rider pickup, he may keep it for quite a while.
Yeah, he can go Lightning Bolt into Argent Horse Rider with the one overload next turn, ride that right into a Doomhammer, and should have board control at that stage, or if not, very even board state. So
a very nice trade setup.
Managed to navigate that early game quite well, despite what was maybe not the best of hands.
Tell you what, that's a pretty good pickup for Teray, though. That's about one of the best ones he was going to get, I think.
Yeah. Stop
going with the Murloc Raider alongside this, that's really interesting to me.
He wants to play the Flame Imp when he knows that he'll be playing Defender of Argus, I think, to try and get more power.
Earthshock, I wonder how that influences anything here, or if it does.
Earthshock, of course, silences before the damage effect goes off, so it would deal the damage to Imp King boss and not summon a 1-1. Earthshock is a card that Chalky cut one copy of Thing from Below for.
Yep.
He said Thing from Below was one of his lower win rate cards in the matchup, the second one, and realized that Earthshock could just be used since he's not banning Druid to get through Ancients of War.
I think this is going to be Earthshock here, and I don't know if he trades or not. Looks like he's not going to trade, so this makes Defender of Argus a little bit stronger here. So favoring the damage definitely matters, but denying Defender of Argus is really important here. It's Teray's turn five. He can play a one drop and Defender of Argus, and this is massively punishing.
Yeah, Chalky probably used that Earthshock thinking no Defender of Argus in hand, and definitely got punished for it. Defender of Argus being the only thing that really punishes that play. So now Chalky probably gonna have to equip the Doomhammer and just clear off a little bit of the board, but.
That's a lot of life to pay.
Yeah. But what else do you do? His only other option would be to slam the 4-mana 7-7 and just clear off the Imp King boss, but you're still taking just almost as much damage, pretty much as much damage as you would.
I don't mind the Lava Burst here. It's definitely the weakest card in your hand, and the fact that you can get value from the weakest card in your hand I think makes a lot of sense, but he wants the Doomhammer development here, and so yes, it does cost him a lot of life. Yes, this does kind of muck his draw up a little bit and mess with his curve. But the thing about it is, if he doesn't see Forbidden Ritual, this is the kind of play that can get him in the game. And it just so happens to be that Teray has Forbidden Ritual. So Chalky is under an immense amount of pressure here and probably needs that Lightning Storm if he's going to recover.
That is correct. And only one copy of Lightning Storm in the deck. So it's not the most likely thing in the world. So I think now.
That's an interesting draw. Because I feel like that could soak up a lot of damage. I mean, it's a pretty high priority kill.
Could soak up three.
Well, that's, I mean, soaking up three minions is a lot on this board position, considering Doomhammer can clear it up. But yeah. He's got 10 in hand just from the Lava Bursts.
Maybe also there's a merit to not playing a minion because you want to keep the board at a lower power total. You don't want him to be able to trade in small 1-1s.
That's a really good point. So, I mean, his board is full. Teray actually can't play a minion here. That's an interesting point. So four,
it's 8 power.
I mean, that gives you 2 turns if there's no buff.
Yeah.
And the only buff available there is Power Overwhelming.
So he would deal 9 damage each turn with just the damage that he has from hand with double Lava Burst plus. So it'd be 9 damage a turn. So he would give himself the out of basically Rock Biter weapon of an out. And he feels like he should have at least a turn to do it, maybe even 2.
Yeah, I think the Flame Wreath is good here for that exact same reason you mentioned. So if the Flame Wreath gets traded into by Power Overwhelming, I think that buys him one extra turn. And when the Flame Wreath doesn't get checked here, he's just threatening lethal. So Teray is actually forced to play action here to take care of this Flame Wreath Faceless, and that buys Chalky even more time.
He just needs to be able to have 2 turns. He has to have 2 turns because now he doesn't have that out of being able to have a Rock Biter weapon because he can't double Lava Burst next turn because he's too overloaded. So if he only thought that he had 1 turn, Lava Bursting face and going face was the better play. But on the line where he thinks he has more than that, then this play is obviously better because he gets to buy himself more time.
Yeah, very nice. So many. Very nice spot there from Chalky. And Teray, fairly limited options. You know, given that Chalky just hit you twice with the Doomhammer instead of any of your minions, Teray's really got to think about, can I even life tap here?
Yeah. Will I have enough power versus.
And if he was going to life tap, he definitely should have life tapped first. Picks up Defender of Argus. That is a huge draw for Teray right now.
Well, I guarantee you it was played.
Yep.
It's floating there.
A little bit of a spectator issue. We'll get this fixed as quickly as we can.
Yeah.
on this side of the board. But yeah, the guarantee that Defender of Argus is stuck on the 2-3 and the 1-1 right next to it.
Yeah. Okay, there we go. Magic. So now Chalky is basically dead. Okay. So he's got Lava Burst the 3-4 and developed the Tunnel Trog and hit into the 2-2. So he takes 2, he goes down to 9, and he leaves 4 power on the board. So he's dead to Doomguard.
Well, it's really the only plays that he's got. And so he knows that Leeroy being the only burst damage outside of power overwhelming, that play can still succeed sometimes. And it might even be in a position where Chalky can afford to hit one of the imps here instead. I don't think it is.
He needs to put Terray at 15, I think, to give himself the Rockbiter out.
You're absolutely right. So he still does have time, though. I mean, Terray's got to kill this Tunnel Trog. Oh, no, it does not. Back-to-back huge draws for Terray. He's going to lock up game number one. That Aggro Shaman, such a good deck, but I'll tell you what. When Zoo draws really well. You do not beat that deck when it's firing on all cylinders.
Yeah, that was hard to watch a little bit towards the end there from Chalky's perspective. I feel like both players gave themselves outs to win. Chalky, maybe, I don't know. It's really hard to say, but I think he gave himself the best outs to win that case.
The only thing that we had to look at that could have been different was his hero power choice. And when he chooses the rogue hero power, it's almost certain that Shapeshift or Fire Blast aren't there, the Druid or the Mage hero powers. And in that matchup in particular, you're probably foregoing Life Tap since you just need to favor enough board control until you find your damage. And given that he had 2 Lava Bursts in hand, when would he ever have found time to Life Tap?
Exactly.
So I'm guessing his other options are somewhere in the neighborhood of like the Totems or the Silverhand Recruits or something of that nature. The Rogue one probably was just the best out of those 3.
And a lot of times, it's if you want board control, it's just the best period.
Right.
If you're willing to use your health as a resource and take the damage. So who knows what they were, but that might have been the only thing I could think of. But Terray getting himself on the board that early is incredibly important, especially with a win like that where you just make your opponent feel bad.
Yeah, it's probably the weakest deck out of his lineup when you consider the Warrior and the Druid. Now, that being said, the Warrior is a very traditional, greedy C'Thun Warrior build. It's not the heavy draw potential sweep out the board and get a little bit more aggressive. It's relying on Gore Howl and Sylvanas to carry some of the heavier weight. And against Chalky's lineup with Rogue and with Tempo Mage and with Aggro Shaman, I'm not sure that deck has the time to get to that stage.
No, especially the greedier C'Thun Warrior decks tend to struggle a little bit against Tempo Mage because they don't have the consistency of early removal.
Right.
It's basically Fireworks or Bust, because if you're just playing a minion, if you're just playing a Beckoner of Evil or a C'Thun's Chosen, then you're just going to get tempoed out. I mean, C'Thun's Chosen is just a ping and an Arcane Blast away from being sweeped off the board. So
I'll tell you what, though, if you're going to draw those opening hands, you can play this greedy C'Thun Warrior deck all you want. There's 1 copy of Acolyte of Pain in here, and he does have 2 copies of Bash. But picking up the Ravaging Ghouls alongside the Acolyte of Pain, the 1 of Acolyte of Pain, while you have coin, this is so important for Terray to get going very early on. Mm-hmm.
We mentioned earlier how Terray's C'Thun deck is a little bit greedy, but it also has some early techs that I really like. Acolyte of Pain can be a clunky card against fast decks, so he only has 1. He's got the double bash, as you mentioned, which is great against those faster decks. It gives you that consistency of removal that I was talking about. If you misfire War Axe, you can get a bash to remove a high priority target. And he's cut C'Thun's Chosen, which is one of those clunkier, he's cut one of them, which is one of those clunkier cards that you don't want in some matchups.
Yeah.
And Temple Mage is one of them. Rogue can sometimes be one of them too because of backstab plus a dagger hit removes it off the board. So
it's also got 2 Beckoner of Evils, which is something you don't always see. Mm-hmm. The thing I'm curious about is if you're going to cut a C'Thun's Chosen and you're going to cut an Acolyte of Pain and add a 2nd Beckoner of Evil, I think you just cut the Acolytes and go for slams. Slams are totally missing from Terray's build.
That's actually a really good point.
2nd Bash gets picked up. Terray has all the early game he needs, I think, to get through this. And Chalky, with a hand of... something else to note, Chalky's only got 1 SI7 agent in his build. The hand that he's got right now, this is not going to get the job done. He needs to find some card draw. He needs to find 2 Pillagers and eventually a Questing Adventurer or an Edwin Van Cleef.
It's going to be tough. Traditionally, players have touted a Rogue as being a favorable matchup against Warrior, but it's a lot closer nowadays, and it's if you ask a lot of the very heavy rogue players, they'll say it's kind of a toss-up. Yep. At some stages.
It's kind of gone historically way back and forth. Like, very early on, Rogue absolutely destroyed Control Warrior builds. And then as Control Warriors got Shield Maiden, you kind of saw it go the other way. The impact of the armor plus the threat in one card was a little bit too much to deal with. The C'Thun Warrior kind of represents the same thing, except because it's so heavy with C'Thun cards, it doesn't usually get going as early as this. But again, Stray's Hand's just fantastic for it. So I think Chalky's got a big uphill battle here.
Yeah, Azure Drake can be a really great card in this matchup because Bash doesn't reach it well, and it does cycle through your deck. So it poses a threat and draws a card. But all of these, well, I guess having one SI agent, this is probably the matchup where you'd want it because it's just going to eat Bashes or Fiery War Axes all day long, and the two damage is rarely relevant. You'd rather have that Questing Adventure.
That's the big thing that Chalky has to consider in this matchup, too, is how does being Bash in this list affect things. And so,
this guy's
depending on how you look at this, Chalky may have missed a point of damage here by not swinging on turn two, because next turn he could have daggered up and swung with one charge. So he's probably looking to a couple of future turns. And so this Bash really, again, changes that, where he's almost certainly never going to be saving the dagger. So I think Chalky may have just missed a point of damage this game.
The time will tell. We'll see. He was banking on the Tomb Pillager draw, I suppose,
yeah,
in the next couple turns.
It's definitely an important one.
Is what he was doing, trying to play to his strongest draw instead of trying to play to his current hand.
Yeah.
Which you can't fault him for that.
Rogue is really interesting in that way, where Amnesiac put this to me best. Like, I do not perform very well with Rogue since the initial Gadgets and Auctioneer change. Like, since then, I have not ever done well with Rogue. And he said to me, you have to play with cards that you don't actually have yet. And what he meant by that was cards that you could potentially draw. Sometimes you just have to pretend as though you're going to draw them and play the game that way. And Rogue kind of thrives on that since it has so many flexible options.
It's a really good way to put it, actually. And I like it. The young savage at it again with his advice.
That kid is something else.
So he's moving his way through. He fell down to the lower bracket earlier, but back-to-back champions, perhaps. We'll see.
Ooh, backstab's a nice draw here for Chalky as well. Holding that Acolyte of Pain to strictly one draw. Now, that being said, he may just want to save the backstab and go into like an Auctioneer backstab prep turn, but I think denying the draws here is really important. You haven't seen Teray play a C'Thun card yet, and if you can actually hold him off of that for long enough, he might struggle to activate some of those big effects.
And very true. And protecting your Azure Drake as well from just having one out as opposed to having two, like in this case. What I think Chalky's doing well, though, is keeping the armor total in check by swinging with his dagger, not holding onto it, being greedy with it. He's managed to take off three health now, so it's better than nothing.
This is a really big turn for Chalky. This is probably the most critical turn of the game, and it's probably not going to get more important than this turn for him. He has to decide, is saving Auctioneer worth more than expending it right now? Is there ever a chance that I can risk a Questing Adventurer here and hope that Teray can't remove it? Those are very difficult things to decide.
So Questing Adventurer, Gadget and Auctioneer played on the board with Prep plus Eviscerate, or maybe you'd use Prep plus Shadow Strike because it's harder to use.
Yeah, I think in this matchup that you would use the Shadow Strike, Teray is already damaged at this point, so you can never point that at face. And there's not too many five health threats or in Teray's deck. I mean, it's really limited to
Sylvanas,
Windrunner, and then an efficient strike on a Twin Emperor. But outside of that, really not that much. Actually just going to go with Eviscerate, attack with the dagger, and pass. This is really interesting to me. I'm curious where this line ends up for the most part with Chalky.
Well, we'll see, but he's sort of banking on Gadget and Auctioneer getting more than just a guaranteed two, because he would have to draw almost exactly Prep into Conceal to protect that.
It's a great brand from Teray here. There's the priority threat of the brand, which needs to be taken care of in the face of Twin Emperor. Now, that Conceal, I mean, this may trap Chalky into the Gadget and Auctioneer at this point. When I say trap, I don't necessarily mean that, but Gadget and Auctioneer Conceal into Prep Shadow Strike, or even just some combination of those this turn, very likely. Brand needs to be dealt with because Twin Emperor on this would just be lights out.
Even Ancient Shield Bear, Rogue just has a limited amount of damage.
Yeah.
And a lot of times you're banking on just pushing a lot of damage in a single turn, so you got to remove that. But, I mean, that's the best draw off the top. You talked about playing with cards you don't have, and I think the Conceal was what Chalky was hoping for.
So there's going to be the Shadow Strike. He draws Sap for the token that's made by Twin Emperor. He draws a second copy of Shadow Strike, and now he's got Questing Adventurer Blood Mage in his hand as well. So that C'Thun's chosen really not doing anything here. And Chalky looks like he may be able to just outright answer the Twin Emperor and do so very cleanly at that.
Oh, yeah. Very nicely done. Also, hold on to the dagger, realizing that he's probably going to have to use all of his mana over the next two turns, or at least the next turn. And he's almost always going to hit in. And turn seven, you always expect the Twin Emps to come out, and Chalky does have the way to deal with it.
Here we go. Sap almost certainly going to be the lead here, I'd say. It'll leave you with six mana left over. And just enough to evaluate, I'd say.
Do you play Questing Adventurer?
I don't think he can afford to right now because the Twin Emperors need to be answered.
He can answer them with the Questing Adventurer, but he pretty much banks on drawing a zero mana spell with the backstabber prep to deal with the C'Thun's Chosen.
Well, the other thing too is you can kind of force removal spells with Gadgetzan Auctioneer and just the crew, and then eventually force down a Questing Adventurer or an Edwin Van Cleef. Those are both like realistic things here too. So if this is not Blood Mage Shadow Strike, it is Shadow Strike and attack with dagger. And I'm not sure which one's better here. I mean, maybe it would have been Questing Adventurer, but if he doesn't know he had that Edwin or a second Questing Adventurer, so it's a really tough call to make, I think.
See what he picks up. Deadly Poison. If he can pick up a backstab. Only one left in the deck, and he went face. That means no. But what he's doing is he's putting on damage. Yep. Leroy double Cold Blood in the hand.
This is going to be really dangerous for Teray coming up. And Shield Slam, not horrible, but he's got to find a way to get this under control. Chalky, his hand is going to be good at this point. He just drew a lot of cards, and that's something Teray's going to consider this turn, is how greedy can I get? Do I need to be more aggressive with my removal spells and expend them now and hope that that's going to work? Like, Blood Mage is a real threat in this matchup. And at the same time, you don't want to kill it, because do you want to give Chalky another card?
Yeah. Another card that you're not making awkward for him to trade in or anything along those lines. You're effectively telling him that you're scared of it. So you do want to gain armor, though. You want to fit in an armor up. So maybe just trade in and Disciple of C'Thun.
I'm looking at like Bash Ravaging Ghoul being a potential play here.
Okay. Just get rid of the Divine Shield off the C'Thun Chosen, but push face for four.
He really wants to get this Twin Emperor down. And if he doesn't attack this Blood Mage, this is going to look bad. So yeah, very important to take out that Blood Mage. Don't let Cold Bloods be a big factor. And there's another Conceal picked up. There's another Sap. I mean, this is another really tough turn for Chalky.
You can go Questing Adventurer, Sap, and then Edwin Conceal.
And I think that's what he's looking for, is to try to force something really uncomfortable from Teray. You know, a brawl in this spot, if another minion's not added alongside of it, that brawl does not look very okay.
No, if C'Thun's Chosen lives, that's a lot of resources effectively removed forward for very little spent from your side, but that's so risky. You leave one up, spending five mana that turn.
This has to be Brawl. Oh my gosh, and I forgot about the dagger.
Yeah, that makes it almost guaranteed that he's gonna be effective here.
Yeah, well, this is hope point at this stage. If he leaves these minions up untouched, Teray's just gonna die this next turn.
Yeah, so he's got, if Questing Adventurer lives, which would be the max amount of damage, he's got Leroy double Colba, which is 14. It would also be three cards. Questing Adventurer would be 8, so it'd be 22, plus a dagger hit would be 23.
I mean, you see him eyeing the Bash here. That was like actually his first instinct was Bash.
Bash the face.
That was the first card he touched was Bash. But looking over the situation, this is a really tough call to make. If he ends up going with the Twin Emperor, he's going to die.
He's dead.
If he goes with Bash, he's going to die.
He's dead.
If he goes with, say, Disciple of C'Thun and Brawl, there's a 33% chance to clear both minions, and I don't think Teray's getting a better chance than that.
Yeah. That is the best chance by far to live. Brawl by itself, removing only the questing adventure, would allow him to live as well.
Oh, here we go, TJ.
Oh, here we go. Chalky had some...
He looks uncomfortable. Chalky looks so uncomfortable.
Oh, my goodness.
Disciple of C'Thun wins the Brawl. That is unbelievable. Chalky just...
Wow.
Chalky looks floored.
I mean, I would be too. That is brutal. That is absolutely brutal. I mean, great job by Teray to spot the play that wins him the majority of the time. So, you know, a lot of players there might panic and brawl right away. They might feel like they need to fit in an armor up. But realizing that your best out is Disciple of C'Thun plus Brawl, that's a 33% chance to just almost win the game on the spot.
Realizing your best chances is a skill in of itself. Teray, I don't think, did anything wrong this game. His list is where my major concern is, but he's played it to the best that the hand has allowed him to play it so far.
Yeah.
And so he just ends up on the right side of the coin this time.
And now Chalky's got to find a way back into this game after using so many resources to get those cards online. But now C'Thun's just going to come down and...
Well, if it doesn't kill that Azure Drake, that could be a problem. And now, granted...
It's very, very likely to kill the Azure
right,
Drake.
But that's something to consider.
Yeah. And, I mean, there's still an out for Chalky here. Does he have any points of direct damage left in his deck?
I believe it's just that one Eviscerate is all. Yeah, that's it. I mean, he's got another Auctioneer. He's got two Pillagers.
Deadly Poison. Deadly Poison.
Yeah, there are two copies of Deadly Poison. So I honestly like this play better from Teray. I think this is way more secure. I think this buys him better time. The fact that the C'Thun can fail, albeit minuscule, I think Teray can just capture a better percent chance to win than that.
Yeah, you're almost guaranteed to win if you just wait it out and play C'Thun when you're guaranteed a victory, essentially. And you know that Chalky has a very limited amount of damage left in his deck. He's got one questing adventure, but very little direct damage.
I mean, Fan of Knives probably needed to be the pickup here for Chalky, and the hope would have been, I think, Leroy, Cold Blood, Fan of Knives, Eviscerate the Ravaging Ghoul, and hope that Leroy lives. Because he's seen Disciples of C'Thun at this point. He knows that the Twin Emperor is the last card, that he really has a wall to get through, and then maybe he can just pick up a... another Deadly Poison and take care of it. It's really tough, but I just don't know if he's got the card economy left to win this.
It's really tough. Both Tomb Pillagers, maybe he can get a threat to stick, but the thing is, it's not like Old Control Warrior where you could just keep beating them down and they wouldn't win for a while. It's a lot different. C'Thun will end the game.
Yeah, now they have a 12-12 or greater that deals 12 damage and can end the game. And here it's just going to be Twin Emperor Shield Slam, and this is almost certain to lock it at this point, I'd say.
And Chalky gives off a little bit of a sigh, but...
I mean, now he's just in C'Thun range. So even in the event that he drew Auctioneer and was able to take care of this board, the Auctioneer would die to the C'Thun most likely, and then there'd be nothing left. Tomb Pillager's just too little too late. And I think you're likely to be closing in on the concession here.
Very true. Chalky is an emotional player, but he doesn't usually let those emotions affect his play. But he's got to be feeling bad after the last couple of games with how they've gone.
You just saw it in his face, his reaction to it.
Exactly.
You know, he had a 67% chance to outright win the game, and it failed.
Mm-hmm. Well, now he's got to try and find the best chance to win. Now that he has to face this down, but I just don't see a way. He has to just take damage or use Leroy to remove just this 4-6 taunt off the board.
Honestly, I think it is his best chance, but this just isn't going to work. Yeah, that's going to do it. C'Thun will come down and end this game. And Teray going to take a 2-0 lead. But there's a bit more to it than just that 2-0 lead to talk about here.
Yeah. Very close games. Both games being on sort of the brink of victory for Chalky. And Teray just manages to claw his way out of really tough situations. So Yeah, now Chalky has to win 3 times in a row against the remaining deck from Terray, which I'm pretty sure is just a Druid.
Yeah, so 2 things I want to stress here. Number one, how well Terray has been using his resources. At every single step of the way, we have seen him take the right risks, and we've seen him slow it down when it wasn't right to take the risks. Mm-hmm. Now, the Druid build, it's very clear that Chalky's lineup is trying to target Druid. He's got Rogue left in here with Questing Adventurers, he's got Tempo Mage with Firelands Portal, and he's got Aggro Shaman with a copy of Urshock in it. All three of these decks are lined up at beating Druid. And the thing about it is, you'll take a few percentage points off of your other matchups to try to secure that win. Druid's the second most popular deck at the event right now. And while it's definitely an uphill battle, Chalky's, of course, at a disadvantage, this could be a reverse sweep. And it's honestly, I don't think it's terribly unlikely.
It could. And to add on to sort of that storyline, every time Chalky plays in a tournament that I cast, I ask him for a quote. And he said, when I asked for a quote this time, he said, "Druid will do bad." That's what that's the quote that he gave me verbatim. So if that's anything to go off of, this was what his game plan was intended to do. It was beat this deck right here. And there's a turn one mana worm.
Yep, he's going to queue up his best matchup first, which is, of course, the Tempo Mage. And Chalky, not like a really interesting build, I'd say, but there's a couple choices in here that look really cool. The first one is the Firelands Portal.
New card!
The second one is he's gone with 2 copies of Forgotten Torch. And that's a card that we really have not seen much in Tempo Mages at all. But he believes that with Firelands Portal, you have the ability to just kill all your opponent's minions in a row and then either have the backup with extra Roaring Torches in your build or the Yogg-Saron afterwards.
This deck, if you give it an inch of room, it will burn you out of the game.
You give it an inch, it takes a mile.
Yeah, or it takes 30 damage. So that's what it'll take. But yeah, this deck is scary when it's given a little bit of wiggle room. And
that being said, Teray's opening hand is about as good as it gets.
Yeah.
He's got turn one Fandral into turn two Power of the Wild.
Just get rid of that mulch and pick up kept the mulch, or did he?
I think he mulliganed into that hand, I believe. But either way, Chalky has a lot of work to do here. He chooses to mulligan away the Fireball, which I'm a little bit surprised by, since one of the ways that Druid finds its big win rate in this matchup is quite literally just playing an early thing that you can't deal with. So Chalky needs Arcane Blast, which actually wouldn't do it here. Now that I'm thinking about it, he needs a good Arcane Missile or Frostbolt. Those are the pickups he's looking for. That actually is not too bad either. That allowed him to get the mirror images on board, which could buy him maybe enough time to get to find Azure Drake or Fireball.
Yeah.
And if he picks a Fireball on 3, it means he can play it since Sorcerer's Apprentice is online. So does give himself some outs, but he's behind.
To say the least.
To say the least, exactly. The one thing he does have a resource advantage, but that's not from his perspective. That's from our perspective, judging by Teray's hand, so he's going to feel like he's very behind, especially since Tempo Mage prides itself in being able to get ahead on the board as early as turn 2 with their early minions and spells.
Acolyte of Pain's not the draw he was looking for, so this is, I think, probably relegated to Acolyte of Pain, trade the Sorcerer's Apprentice into the Panther, and then attack face for 2. That buys him effectively another turn with the Mana Worm. It's not necessarily dead, and then Forgotten Torch or Frostbolt can still secure the job.
What to do?
And could start trying to dig a little bit more. He might need to hope that Teray doesn't have any other cards that benefit with Fandral, which is the case at the moment. But with Innervate, any draw that has a choose one effect that would be in Teray's deck besides Cenarius.
Yes, he is going to deliberate the trade into Fandral and Hero Power it, but I think that's just far too weak on board to justify. Trading into the Fandral and Hero Powering would just be, like, super greedy. You're like, I hope you can't capitalize with any other minion, versus this way, I hope you can't capitalize with a second, a second choose one effect.
Mm-hmm.
And so here, Teray is debating the Innervate Mulch, which it looks like he's going to go for, try to deny draws to Chalky, and hope that works out.
But now Chalky knows exactly what those cards are. because he moused over Innervate, which would only be one mana. It could be Living Roots, but he wouldn't be pointing it at anything. So he wouldn't be able to do it because of choose one. And then it would be a 3-mana spell that you can target at something.
Yeah, I think there's a small chance it could be Living Roots, but
could be
a very small chance.
Yeah,
but no, Wrath would have been played here first for sure.
Yeah, but Chalky is a player that reads hands exceptionally well.
Yes.
So he would know, not that it matters, but it might down the line.
Time waits for no one.
This is pretty much the most important turn of the game right here for Chalky. Honestly, the Innervate Mulch is a really strong spot here from Teray to deny draws. Like, what random minion can punish you here? Like, Iron Beak Owl, Spellbreaker, that's about it.
Emperor Cobra can do it as well.
Well, picks up Fireball. That's probably a little too late, though. Cannot couple it with a hero power. But you'll probably be seeing the Fireball here anyway. It's looking like Fireball and Fandral run the Mana Worm into the Panther and set up Hero Power plus the Emperor Cobra next turn. Teray only has one card in hand, and the choose one effect that's massive at this point would be Nourish. And Teray's one mana off of that, so there's still a little bit of breathing room here.
Chalky says this deck has become sometimes about value, and Chalky is going to get more value out of his cards over the long run here. Even though Teray has gotten this early game lead, Chalky has what he needs to stabilize. It's just over a few turns.
I'm curious if there's ever merit to attacking the Fandral here anyway to prevent Raven Idol from being a big deal. And so this is the kind of turn that Chalky was hoping for, was quite literally do nothing.
Yeah.
And now there's a chance he can get back in. That Druid of the Claw.
Cobra ping.
Well, the Druid of the Claw is checked by the Emperor Cobra right now. And it's not like Teray is the aggressor at this moment. He expended all of his resources, and all it really did was disrupt Chalky.
Wow. So Chalky's going to debate here whether or not Emperor Cobra is the right call, considering we're still a turn away from Ancient of War. He's going to have two cards left in his hand. On an empty board, Wrath would punish it, but I don't think you really take the chance. You challenge the minion that's going to come out.
Yeah, it's definitely Emperor Cobra when you consider what Teray's list looks like. There is Emperor Thorson in here, and Azure Drake, and Druid of the Claw, which is pretty darn greedy, all things considered.
Yeah.
The thing about it is, this is the situation that Teray's trying to create, is get to the end game on a very safe position and hope that the card quality he draws just outmatches his opponent.
Yeah. So Teray is thinking about whether or not to charge here. Charging gets more value considering Emperor Cobra's going to challenge it. But it also gets punished by, okay, charging it and killing it is the safer play because you don't want it to be spell powered plus Arcane Blast.
That would be the nightmare.
Yeah.
And
so Chalky, definitely smart.
Chalky here with Azure Drake is looking so good. So Teray is going to drop that Ancient of War next turn. The Firelands Portal is going to deal 6. He can trade him with the Azure Drake, and he comes away with a 5-cost minion.
Not bad.
It's about as good as it gets.
All right, new card hype. Firelands Portal. This is what it was made for.
What is the worst card he could get off of Firelands Portal?
There's some bad 5 drops.
What's the worst one, though, like stat-wise?
Oh, I don't know. No, there's 4/4s. There's Cold Apothecary.
I'd rather have a 4/4 than a 3/5.
Okay. Psychotron.
Psychotron would be great.
Psychotron's pretty good, but Psychotron's weakest when you're talking about a druid who has no resources because it gives them an excuse to use their hero power.
That's the law.
Harrison Jones, not bad. I'll take a 5/4.
Sure.
Hey, that's a pretty darn good 5/4 that deals 5 damage.
Yeah.
Or in this case, 6.
And now Teray can't play everything. He wants the Druid of the Call, Wrath plus hero power. But he can't do that. He has to play one or the other. And Druid of the Call is going to be the option, which...
Well, it's also just checked from Chalky's hand. He's got a copy of Fireball in it. And with the Accolade of the Pains that Chalky's included, that's another very uncommon choice. But it looks like it's going to get him some very massive value this game.
Oh, yeah.
So the choice here for Chalky is card economy or pressure.
Chalky's about to turn the corner on this one.
Sorcerer's Apprentice...
Flamewaker
into Fireball looks pretty darn good, but I really like the idea of getting more card draw online and trying to just absolutely choke out to raise resources after that.
I mean, you can still just develop the Flamewaker and the next turn Acolyte plus ping it.
This is going to come down to...
Okay, Acolyte it is.
Yeah, this is going to come down to what the turn to kill timer was. And so Chalky did some very generic math here and determined that it's not very consistent to figure out how often you kill your opponent. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Well, there's always one way to turn a game around, TJ.
And that's Yogg-Saron. But the thing is, he hasn't used that many spells.
He's got quite a few. Innervate, Coin,
Power
of the Wilds, a Wild Growth, a Wrath.
That's 6.
Just drew a Raven Idol.
Oh, okay. Well,
Well, he's dogging next turn 100%.
So Chalky knows that, because you Wild Growth at 9.
Unless it's just a blunder, which Teray usually doesn't do,
yeah.
This is probably Yogg-Saron. And so I'm curious how Chalky goes about this. I wonder just if he actually extends with the Flamewaker here or just waits.
I mean, there's been, what, 7, 8 spells cast? Arcanine likes a fantastic pickup. He can just spend this whole turn drawing cards, not have to develop anything, probably still force Teray to use Yogg unless he draws into something insane.
Chalky draws his own Yogg.
Okay.
One of them's golden, though.
I think Chalky's whole deck is golden.
You know me, I think golden's way better.
Yeah. Maybe play one? Nah, okay.
It just comes down to time to kill. So if he attacks for 6 here, he sets Teray to 15. The hero power sets up. Let's just say he hero powers. Goes back to 16, and then you're looking at 8 from hand, plus the Flamewaker, which would be 4 more. So you have 12 from hand afterwards. Yeah, Chalky just says this is enough. And Teray, so far behind, he doesn't have time to nourish. He just has to Yogg right now.
Dragon's Breath does.
Oh, cool. That's not the right target. That's a pretty good one. That's not good.
Another Dragon's Breath.
You could never tell where that's pointed.
I know. It just goes somewhere. Holy Wrath.
Right target. That actually will kill Teray if he does not find a way to heal or protect himself here.
Ball of Spiders doesn't help, and I think that's it.
Well, two ball of spiders might what? Help. So that's absorbing a lot of the potential Flamewaker damage here.
I think with, Forgotten Torch, Frostbolt Ping.
He drew another Forgotten Torch. I didn't see that quite yet. So Chalky will come away with game number 3.
Let's How in the world?
He's bringing back the comeback. That was after Teray had turn 1 Fandral into turn 2 Power of the Wild.
Yeah, that is nuts. Just shows you sort of the strength of Tempo Mage in this deck and the way Chalky sort of built it. Firelance Portal, I don't want to call it the MVP of this matchup, but having a way to deal what that card is usually in place of is Flamestrike. Flamestrike would not have done the job in that scenario.
Absolutely not.
Nor would have really any other cards. He maybe an Arcane Blast, but not developing a minion that turn would have been a big deal. So Chalky going to go ahead and put himself on the board, and now 2 relatively favorable matchups once again.
The only thing I think to consider there is whether or not Teray should have charged the second Druid of the Claw into Harrison Jones. That would have bought him quite a bit of life. And while I don't think it's necessarily going to affect the outcome of that game, when you see 2 Ball of Spiders from Yogg-Saron, if you're at a high enough life total, the extra beasts you pick up can definitely win you some games.
There are, I think Sottl said it earlier, it's sometimes it's just a Yogg game.
Yes.
And you have to realize that as quick as possible to know, am I just playing my spells to stay alive? Am I just using my cards to stay alive? Or am I or am I actually trying to win the old-fashioned way, and that's by taunting up my Druid of the Claw and hero power in the face. So it's definitely a consideration, but I don't really know if I don't know. It's really tough to say.
Yeah, I think in hindsight, charging is better because it almost certainly was Yogg game. If you look at just the card economy,
Chalky had 4 cards in hand.
Plus, you have to consider the list. I mean, Teray knows the list at this point. He knows there's 2 Acolytes. He knows there's a Yogg-Saron. He knows that there's 2 Arcane Intellects. He knows there's a second Firelance Portal. Like, are you really going to grind Chalky out of that game by taunting up your Druid of the Claw and forcing a hero power? No.
Yeah.
That's definitely not going to happen.
Not going to happen. Teray is restarting his client. Was getting just a little bit of lag at the end of that series there. So it'll just be just a moment before we jump back in the next game just to update you guys. But talking about the remaining matchups, Chalky's got to win twice in a row still. But he's going in with a Questing Adventurer Rogue, which 10 to have pretty good matchups against Druid because not unless it's Ancient of War and they don't have a sap, that's the only way you can block a concealed anything from being able to hit you in the face. And Shaman, they just hit you in the face even earlier than that. So.
Right. So the 2 things that Teray has going for him in this matchup is that considering the Shaman build, there's both Druid of the Claw and there's Ancient of War in here. So the potential to stabilize the board just by taunting a lot is a very realistic thing. Chalky does have an Earthshock for that, though. So that is going to be kind of the situation you're looking for there. With the Rogue build, it's in kind of a similar spot where Druid of the Claw has the potential to absorb Sinister Strike, which is a very easy way to start chewing through an Ancient of War. But if he can't secure the board after getting a Druid of the Claw, Sinister Strike.
Shadow Strike,
sorry. Yeah. That's really where things are going to become a major problem. And so it's, I think it's quite literally boiling down to whether or not Teray can land multiple taunts in a row and keep the early game checked.
So a couple things to note going into this matchup. Chalky runs Earthshock in his Shaman build, which allows him to push through those taunts. Also, Teray doesn't have Violet Teacher.
Right, and that's like...
Just straight up doesn't have it.
It's like one of the ways that you beat Shaman is by just getting a board presence to that card. Now, the other things to note is that Chalky does have a copy of Lightning Storm in his build, which is very weak in this matchup. It's quite literally probably the worst card. But he also knows there's only one copy of Mulch inside of Teray's Druid deck. So Flame Wreath Faceless goes up massively in value when you consider that.
It does. The Lightning Storm tends to be okay against the Violet Teacher versions or any version that runs, which is what we've seen today, Wisps of the Old Gods. But Teray just is very close to a just ramp druid.
That's honestly probably a better way to say it. It's like Ramp Yogg.
Ramp Yogg. You still have all those early spells, Living Roots, Innervates, Raven Idols, Power of the Wilds, Wild Growths, Wraths. You just don't have sort of the engine where you can just win the game. It's just a more consistent curved mid game. So
Chalky with an interesting opening hand here. I imagine his eye is going to be on turn 3 Flame Wreath Faceless. And it's sort of like mulch check. And if Teray doesn't have it, it's that card can very easily deal 14 damage alone.
Protects me.
Incredibly relevant.
So here we'll get a glimpse of how Teray wants to approach this matchup. Which expending Innervates is definitely a good way to do it. I'm curious if he makes a 2-2 or if he ramps.
Ramping would fit his deck style, but maybe he feels like he needs to get on the board.
Yeah, I like this ramp here from...
Oh, it doesn't ramp.
Teray. I'm sorry, I like the 2-2. Yeah, okay. I don't know why I said ramp. I like the 2-2 here from Teray because this starts to contest the board pressure. So in this situation, Chalky was looking to land Flame Tongue here and attack like a Panther, or maybe in the event that Teray ramped, just attack the Mire Keeper. That extra 2-2 ooze is allowing Teray to fight back on that board. And I'm curious if that's enough to prompt a Rockbiter from Chalky as well.
He goes with Rockbiter. What's his follow-up with that? Does he just Rockbiter? Or does he coin something out as well? You mentioned his plan would be to...
The Flame Tongue's coming down no matter what. Like, this trade has to happen. The question is, does he kill the 2-2 here? And killing the 2-2 here means that Teray can just hero power the 3-1 and Chalky doesn't have a follow-up. And so that's the only... That's like the real issue with this play, is how does he follow up to this? And so he's kind of playing to the hope that he draws either Feral Spirit or Tusker Totemic here.
Which is, there's four of them in his deck, but maybe a Totem Golem. No, Totem Golem you don't want, because you want to play Flame Refaces on four.
Right.
And Teray picks up not really good options. Feral Rage most certainly going to be the pickup here.
Yeah, anything to just fight back is what Teray needs right now. So Soul of the Forest in a control matchup, that'd be fine. Savage Roar, if you were taking the lead, that'd be fine. Neither of those things are happening. And I think Teray, if he doesn't hero power here, could potentially be in really bad shape. Like in the face of Argent Horse Rider, if you choose to use the 3-2, I think you're just suffering a lot. He does have Swipe to pick that up on the back of that, though.
Maybe he wants that to happen.
That's very true. But here's the thing. Is Chalky going to trade in the Divine Shield, or would he trade in the 3-1? Because the 3-1's already exposed to hero power at that point. So that's something else that Teray needs to consider, too, is how Chalky would trade if he had Argent Horse Rider.
Indeed. Well,
you're looking for Finley. You're looking for Tusker Totemic. I think those are the two best ones. Argent Horse Rider's good as well.
Oh,
and that has some massive potential to swing this board. If Chalky gets either Flame Tongue Totem, Manatide Totem, or
Totem
Golem here, Teray is going to be in really bad shape.
A basic totem would still be okay because you're still putting pressure. Maybe not the 1-1, but Taunt Totem would be decent.
Did you bring some
means you sort of just had an extra layer of protection for Flame Wraith. There's a Flame Tongue! Oh my goodness!
That's a big pickup. I mean, that Fandral cannot be played right now.
Yeah, it looks like he might have to just...
I mean, he may have to Feral Rage.
Oh, and then you get a free... Not a free 7-7, but you get an almost automatic turn to go for that Flaming Faces. You're taking, what, at least
pretty gosh darn
5
free.
Damage?
Yeah, that's the thing about it is one of the ways that Druid can contest Flame Wreath Faceless and have it not be as huge of a liability is to have anything on the board to attack it and couple with Swipe. Mm-hmm. That is not going to happen this game.
No. Not at all. And even if Teray does drop one big bomb of a threat, an Ancient of War, or a Miracle Druid of the Claw to try and gain 6 health, it's just going to get Earthshocked, and Jackie's going to keep pushing. That's something that has to play in the back of Teray's mind, since he does know that that's an inclusion in Chalky's deck, and that card's going to sit there for as long as it needs to until one of those minions comes out.
Now, the last thing I see is actually 2 Power of the Wilds, and that puts Chalky in a position where if he trades one of the Flametongue Totems into it, the other one loses its power. So 2 Power of the Wilds here, not an unreasonable option, I don't think, and Teray's going to spot it.
All right, well, very nice spot. Also fills up the mana curb as well.
This probably forces a trade with the 5-2 unless Chalky picks up something here. Yeah, I think Chalky's going to have to trade. Which, again, when you're playing a Flaming Faces afterwards, you're not necessarily too concerned with.
So, and then I think the Flaming Faces is a given in this situation. I think the trades are what Chalky's thinking about.
He's trying to figure out what this means. Is it something else?
Is it even worth trading, or do you just push the 9?
That's a really good question. So if you push 9, Teray falls to 17, and you have Flaming Faceless. He gets to trade over 1. I don't like that, because your nose is going to really be open to swipe Living Roots there.
So you're trying to value the 7-7.
We're going to deviate.
Oh, man.
So Chalky, I got to believe that Flame Wreath Faceless is just vastly superior here.
Maybe he's overthinking things a bit. Maybe he doesn't want to be blown out of the game by a mulch. But I think that's a risk you got to take.
So I'm anticipating trade, or trade attack for 2 and then trade. And that's exactly what Chalky's going to do. So can Teray beat this Flame Wreath Faceless? It's a tall task.
Yeah.
That Fandral, you're kind of just sending Fandral out to die in this spot.
Maybe that's okay.
Maybe. Well, Fandral, I think, more likely to get Lava Burst here than attacked by the Flame Wreath Faceless.
Yeah. And then push 9, put him down to 15. Yeah, it's got to be Lava Burst.
Well, I wonder if there's ever a consideration now for just second Flametongue and Finley, and then use the Earthshock Lava Burst to follow up on whatever Teray might have.
Well, you're thinking, we're rolling into turn 6. It was turn 5 right now. My opponent played a Fandral instead of a Druid of the Claw.
Right, so Chalky can, let's just say he plays Flametongue Totem. He gets to push 11 damage here. That sets Teray to 13. He's still got the Flamewreath Faceless on board. He's got a Finley alongside of it with the Earthshock to back up whatever the taunt is going to be. This is much, much more conservative, and this almost assures you the win. And I think what Chalky just ended up concluding here is there's no reason to take that risk.
Yeah. Just take the free 9 damage, take the easy trade. Don't give my opponent any way unless he has mulch, and specifically mulch.
Which he didn't have last turn, so he probably just doesn't have. And that is not going to do it. So Chalky, 11 total damage available this turn.
13. Oh, no, yeah, 11, because it would... Well,
I'll tell you what, though. Just the fact that he's got Finley and a second Flametongue Totem here is probably just locking the game up. I don't really see how.
Well, it depends on his choices from Finley. You can whiff on that, but there's so many good ones at this stage. When you're getting close to being able to put in the final touches of damage, Steady Shot becomes incredibly relevant. Life Tap becomes incredibly relevant. And we'll see what his choices are. Looks like he's leaning towards that right one, whatever it is. Nope. Okay, so we got ourselves a tough choice on our hands. Pick Shapeshift. Not what I expected.
That Tuskar, I believe, should be on the far side of the Flamewreath Faceless to try to get an extra Flametongue Totem here for more damage. That's about the only positional difference it could make. Face? So potentially lost damage, but playing for the future. Honestly, that could have been any. That could have just not been a totem, and I think Chalky is going to secure this game here. Swipe could have something to say about that, though.
Yeah, he can Feral Rage. Swipe. So what he can do, Feral Rage for 8 armor, swipe the Totem Golem. He'd have to Hero Power into the...
You'd swipe the Flamewreath Faceless at that juncture and attack it with the Azure Drake.
So you'd leave up 6 damage total. You'd Hero Power down the... So you'd leave 5 damage up in that case.
You'd Hero Power down the Flametongue Totem, I believe.
So 4 power. Because you'd leave Finley and Totem Golem up.
Yeah, I don't think he's... Yeah, I don't think he's got a way to get out of this. I mean, the Feral Rage could, again, buy him a little bit extra time here. Mm-hmm.
You're still leaving two targets on the board. But yeah, I think Flame Wreath Faceless.
Time waits for no one.
And he's got to gain the eight.
Yep, so the Innervate, I think, is going to be used here as well. Yep, just buys him that little bit of extra health. So, Flame Tongue Totem alongside of this in Chalky's hand. A lot of cards can end the game effectively here.
We'll see. Shapeshift is not the best in a very long scenario.
That's
but
a very good draw. That pushes a lot of damage for Chalky.
That's 12 total. So he's going to put him down to 3
Don't worry,
health.
Lux, the cavalry's here.
Well, yeah. I think barring a second swipe, that locks up the game. And even with the second swipe, I think it locks up the game, actually.
Because second swipe is just swiping and then ear powering, still is left with power on the board.
Yeah, that's not going to do it. So, Teray going to drop game at number 4 as well.
Uh-oh.
And Chalky, one game away from completing the reverse sweep here. And Rogue is a very good deck against this Druid build.
This is what he was sort of making this lineup to do. And Teray throws out the well played, and his hopes of a 3-0 are gone. His hopes of a 3-1 are gone. Now he's just got to rely on the 3-2, but it's not looking pretty at this stage.
And this is where the mental pressure really gets to you, too. I mean, Teray took a very decisive 2-game lead. And I'm not necessarily sure that Teray was thinking about how fortunate he really got in a lot of those situations. Again, he's been playing really well, but he got pretty lucky to win the first 2 games.
Yeah.
And so now when you've dropped 2 after that, in very decisive fashions, you kind of go, oh, gosh, I mean, what's going on? This Druid deck was performing well. I brought this to this tournament. I'm undefeated so far. Am I about to lose? And when that's your mentality, it's not where you need to be. That can cloud your thought.
And we talked about this matchup in particular, maybe having double Ancients, double Druid of the Claw makes the matchup a little better, but maybe not, because sometimes you just beat Rogue by drawing crazy stuff, and Violet Teacher is usually included in that with Power of the Wild, and Teray just doesn't have the potential to do that because he's chose not to include the Violet Teachers in his list. So it's just a very simple list that Fandral is the only thing that lets you sort of cheat out some of the stuff that you wouldn't normally be able to do.
Yeah.
So.
The only thing about Violet Teacher is that Fan and Ives and Eviscerate is so strong versus a Violet Teacher draw, unless there's Power of the Wild there. And when there's Power of the Wild, then you're hoping your opponent doesn't have like Azure Drake Prep Fan or Blood Mage Fan Eviscerate or some combination of like a spell power with a Fan and Ives. So I think that the Taunt version is a little bit better, but Chalky's brought 2 Shadow Strikes.
2 of them.
Yeah, and that's really the big deal breaker here for me is that Shadow Strike lines up very well versus Druid of the Claw and Ancient of War. Chalky specifically prepared his lineup for these kinds of situations. So if there is a draw I think that could really pull him ahead, it's some sort of early Emperor shenanigans for Teray. Chalky, I don't think he can keep this Gadgetzane Auctioneer, but I think that Questing Adventure and Tomb Pillager are probably going to find a home in this hand.
Yeah, a lot of times you want to find the ideal hand with the perfect spells and minions, but Tomb Pillager is just really good.
Yeah.
And Questing Adventure a lot of times is just really good. Your win condition revolves at least somewhat around those cards in general and getting minions on the board. So having those early is decent. I wouldn't be surprised if he also just only keeps Tomb Pillager.
Yep. There's a lot of different mulligan options here for Chalky, and it just boils down to the way that he's approaching the matchup. I mean, sometimes Rogues tend to be a little bit more responsive and try to answer everything that the Druid's playing. Sometimes Rogues really try to get aggressive and put the pressure test to the Druid. So this mulligan's going to tell us everything about it. Did Chalky just keep the whole hand? Oh, okay. He mulliganed the questing in the Auctioneer away.
I was about to say, oh, Nelly. But gets Edwin Van Cleef, effectively a questing adventure.
Yeah,
just much less potential.
Very important card. If preparation gets picked up for Chalky, it's probably his best draw at the moment. There's a sap as well. So, big Emperor Thoris on turns, I think, is what Teray's going to end up trying to rely on this game. I wonder if there being 2 copies of Shadow Strike ever influences his decision to play a turn 3 Emperor Thoris on.
I wonder.
Yeah. Nobody has. Okay. It's like his hero power is not green.
Oh, yeah. Could have been like a connection thing or something.
Yeah. It was taking a long time, but just goes ahead and daggers up.
This is going to be a really interesting turn for Chalky now. I'm really curious if backstab Edwin is good enough.
And I don't know. He's got coin. It dies to just a Wrath coin plus a hero power, so.
Which isn't that big of a deal. You do have two Pillager to follow that up. Mm. But I'm thinking he knows that Bot Teacher's not in here, so Fan of Knives I think is an all right play. But he's just going to favor pressure. He says, let's go.
Yeah. He does have the Questing Adventure, so he doesn't need to go for all in on Edwin. And he does have a follow-up with Tomb Pillager. So if there is a big play used here, and he's going with Emperor Thorsand, which is not a very sappable target. So I definitely like this play.
I think it's definitely sappable when your opponent has innervated coined it out. I think otherwise it's pretty tough to target with it, but when is that Emperor really coming down again if this gets sapped? And honestly, I'm curious with four cards in hand if Chalky's ever going to choose to just ignore this Emperor. You can see him pained about this too, like, I really want to ignore it and just attack, but I don't know if that's going to get the job done.
Yeah, and there's a couple different options for him to remove it too. I think he wants to build a threat here, and I don't know if he wants to use a sap as well when he knows that there's Druid of the Claws as well as Ancients in the deck. So he's probably just going to kill it and then develop a Tomb Pillager. But no, going to go ahead and sap and just push damage.
Oh, he's going to go with this Cold Blood. Chalky, he's really putting a lot of the tournament on this particular play right here. Oh, Swipe gets picked up for Teray. That is a massive draw right now. With Azure Drake and Wrath on turn 5 as well, he can answer the Tomb Pillager. And that sap Cold Blood may have just put Chalky in a spot where he's going to be falling to the lower bracket here.
Yeah, and with Chalky, I mean, Chalky not only wants to make it to the championship, but also he needs to perform well to secure his spot in last place. He's at 74 points, and to make it into the top 8, he's going to need at least 84. So in order to secure 10 points, he's got to get at least like top 32 plus a good finish for Legend Ladder in the season. So falling down the lower bracket, even though it's not super early, it's not round 1, it's not round 2, we are to round 3, it's not the worst thing in the world. You still have to win a lot more than just 2 after this to make it into that top 8, which is ever so crucial.
Yep, Chalky just not drawing the right tools. I mean, he's got one more card to cycle with. He needs to find Questing Adventurer or Gadgets and Auctioneer. I think he's got about 4 cards left in the deck that could potentially win him the game.
This is not looking good at the moment, though.
I think he's got a Fan of Knives. He's going to go with Eviscerate. So Chalky's thinking that the extra time he buys here could be valuable for him. But that Eviscerate right there says to Teray, I can do whatever I want. And that's almost certainly going to mean Ancient of War.
Yeah. Needs Gadgets and Auctioneer right now. Leeroy is probably the worst draw in the deck. With no way to support it, there is some opportunities in matchups as Rogue where you can Leeroy plus Cold Blood and then conceal it to try and go for a 2-turn lethal. But this deck has so many big taunts that are going to get in the way. It's got the Ancients, it's got the Druid of the Claws, it even has Cenarius.
I mean, I
got to put
look,
in one last block.
I got to look back at that opening hand and think, should Chalky have kept a Questing Adventurer or a Gadgets and Auctioneer? Those are win conditions in this particular matchup.
Yeah.
And he threw 2 of them away.
He did.
I don't know if it's, I mean, you need the right tools to operate still. I mean, you need to be able to answer stuff too, but Questing, oh gosh. That's about the worst the hand could get.
A big sigh from Chalky. His next card almost has to be Gadgets and Auctioneer.
His next card has to be Gadgets and Auctioneer.
It can't even be Questing Adventure because this time he doesn't even have enough time to get that big enough for it to become a win condition. And there's Teray's just going to keep doing stuff himself as well. I mean, he could develop Emperor Thorsand. He can even draw cards. He can just do whatever the heck he wants. And just developing Emperor Thorsand puts 10 power on the board. I just don't know.
This is a necessary draw for Chalky. He needs Gadgets and Auctioneer if he wants to keep that upper bracket going. Azure Drake, that's decent.
It's halfway halfway there. Deadly Poison's not, though.
I think he might even have to save this Deadly Poison.
Just to try and get more cards. He needs fodder for the double prep.
That as well. There's so, a lot of things that Chalky needs right now, and it basically just starts with Gadget and Auctioneer. I mean, if he loses this game,
so many options.
That's one step closer to that low point performance. And he needs the points. Like, he's got two chances. This is his first one. The second one is last call, but securing last call requires you to do very well in this tournament.
Yeah, just got picked up by Luminosity Gaming as well, along with a lot of other top-tier North American players, including Soleil, Frozen, Muzzy, PhoneTap still on that team.
I wonder if Cenarius ever just makes two twos here. I mean, normally that's kind of bad in this matchup, but he's already seen two Phantom Knives.
If you're going to trade, then yeah, but why don't you just cut down his time and just get the two twos? You've seen a sap. Just get the plus two going and just hit him in the face.
That's exactly what he's going to do. Chooses to use the Ancient of War power for health rather than the Emperor Thorason.
Hedge against sap, I guess, a little bit. You don't want too much of your stuff weighted in, and trading also still gives him lethal the following turn.
That's it. Yep, Chalky can't win. Wow, what a game for Teray. Turn three, Emperor Thorason can be lights out in a lot of matches.
Into a swipe to deal with the Edwin Van Cleef that was cold-blooded. Just, you know, I got a feel for Chalky a little bit in that situation. Teray did give himself the best chances to win in the games that he was given those draws, but what a brutal loss for Chalky after almost making it.
Yeah, and the Rogue just really underperforming here in this particular series, too. Mm-hmm. 0-2 with the Rogue. Just wasn't anything to give. I mean, I think that the only real decision that could have been different for Chalky is the opening hand on Rogue on game number 5. Should he have kept an Auctioneer or a Questing Adventurer? I don't know, but that's the spot to look at.
And Chalky's going to have to battle it down in the lower bracket. But we're halfway through the day here at day one of the America's Summer Preliminary. So we'll go ahead and take a look at some of the stuff that we've seen so far today. We started off with Hotform versus Mouse the Cat. And it was a pretty close series. Came all the way down to game number 5. We didn't get to see it actually on the stream. But Hotform did manage to take that series in the final control mirror.
Yeah, very big win to pick up for Hotform in that series to keep his dreams alive of making that second consecutive BlizzCon. Has to perform in this tournament. He's not in position for last call. And Frozen picking up a super close series versus a bloody face in a grueling game number 5 of Freeze Mage versus Zoo.
My pick to win, Frozen. Making it happen.
And Nosta, my pick to win. Not able to get the job done in the Druid Mirror. Just taking the game slow and steady and ended up getting pushed out of it. And then this last series. What a great series this one was, though.
Yeah, you can see there, that's the brawl that ended it all for Chalky. Losing that 1-3, or 2-3, I guess it would be from his perspective. Teray falling down after being up 2-0 to 2-2, but manages to pick up that last game. And he'll move on in the winner's bracket, and Chalky will fight down into the lower bracket. But to give you guys a look at what's happening throughout the rest of the preliminary, let's check in over with Soddle at the blackboard.
Thank you, TJ. I am standing by at the blackboard, joined on this occasion by Cora. Cora, you're probably just a little bit sad, Chalky, one of your picks for the tournament, not able to take out that game.
Yeah, it's a little bit disappointing, but you know what? Tari's a great player, so congratulations to him, and I have faith that Chalky can do it even from the lower bracket.
Sure. Well, speaking of lower bracket, let's take a look at the players who are remaining in the tournament, both in the upper and lower bracket. Of course, we started out with a massive 168 players playing across all different locations. And looking at the US West here, most of the big names still alive and kicking. Bradford Lee eliminated. A lot more dropping out in US Central, though.
Yeah, Niles, Illinois just got absolutely destroyed. A little bit disappointing because that is my hometown preliminary location. But no matter. Canada, we are seeing a few important names drop, Newability and Dear Jason, but Cydonia, the previous season's champion, still in it.
Latin America as well, just dropping like flies as well. Tavern Heroes not sticking around too long either. The Rat dropping out early is a bit of a surprise, though. But speaking of Tavern Heroes, let's take a look at one of these Tavern Hero locations. This is, I believe, Ecuador, and it looks like they are getting into the Karazhan party vibe. Looks like a lot of fun going down there in Ecuador. Apparently, this is just how we do it in South America.
You know, you can't fault them for wanting to have fun.
I definitely can.
Okay.
Fun is awful.
Excuse me. You can fault them for wanting to have fun, but I can't.
Anyway, let's move on to some updates that we have on the board here. As you can see, Dog is continuing to bark the opponents away. 3-2 over KO. Muzzy picking up a 3-2 win over Yo It's Flow. Cydonia, the defending champion, picking up a win over Promise. And Fibonacci over Satoros. But the moment that I think you personally have been dreading, Cora, it's time to take a look
I'm
at our predictions board.
I'm not excited for this,
Zottl. So hopefully this board doesn't let me down. Let's try and rotate this bad boy. So far, so good. All right, perfect. So the good news is that first off, well, let's say good news. Good news for me, bad news for you, is that LVYS has been eliminated from the tournament, meaning that he goes down.
You know, I put my faith in a friend. Unfortunately, this time I wasn't rewarded, but it's okay. I still will speak to him on occasion, depending.
Like to do the honors and remove LVYS from
just,
the board.
It's just so sick that they make me do this. It's...
And just very, very quickly as well, one more name going down is Vankswisher from TJ's picks. So if you want to remove him as well. A couple more quick updates. Amnesia is hanging in with a win over Da Ninja. Rosti as well picking up wins over Behavior. But the caster board still not doing too bad apart from Cora and TJ with their controversial picks.
You know, like I said before, I have faith in Shockey. He's got a long road ahead of him, but he's done it before.
All right, you just.
I'm holding on to whatever little bit of hope I have, Zottl.
Yeah, you just keep telling yourself that, Cora. But anyway, standing by is two people who are hopefully going to be a little bit more successful with their picks. On the desk are Frodan and Brian Kibler.